she heard my Jesus was passing by, so she joined the gathering throng. And while she was pushing her way through, someone asked her, "What are you trying to do?" She said, "If I could just touch the hem of his garment, I know I'll be made whole." She cried, "Oh,
yeah. give you a C before you start.
Count your Our hearts, only she can feel. We love her now, and we always will. Oh. That's you, Mother.
Reckon it would be too much for us to have two birthdays again.
A little heavy on us.
Who's that from, Mom?
Ooh, that's pretty.
Oh, that's... Want me to read it?
Okay,
from?
I can't read it.
That's Gwen.
That's
Gwen.
Oh.
Let's love Gail.
That's to you, Gwen.
Oh, to me?
Oh, you can
Okay.
You want me to read? Okay, this is from Gail to me.
What are your glasses?
I'm lucky to have a sister like you. You have so many qualities to admire. So many gifts and talents, so much warmth and kindness you share with our family and with everyone in your life. And even though I don't see it very often since it's your birthday, I just wanted to mention again how special you are to me.
Love you.
And how and how proud I am that you're my sister. Happy birthday. Happiness always. Love you. Thank you, Jackie. She's so good.
And this is
maybe.
Good time.
Had a wonderful time.
All right. Now, where were you born?
I was born in Ashland County.
Okay.
In a little community that was called Deep Creek.
Uh-huh. Okay. What's Deep Creek like? What was Deep Creek like?
Oh, it was a very rural area where my mother's family lived out there.
What was your mom's name?
My mother's name was Nanny Rivers.
Mm-hmm. And tell us a little bit about your mom.
Well, as far back as I can remember, my mom was a In fact, she was not in a...
Was she a good cook? Was she strict on you, or...?
Well, she was a cook. She was a domestic worker.
Mm-hmm.
From the time I can remember. Mm-hmm. I can't remember too much about the farm life.
Okay.
Because she moved to Highland, North Carolina. And that's where we were. You know, that's as far back as I can remember.
You got brothers and sisters?
I have one sister and two brothers.
Okay, what are their names?
My sister is Mary Allen.
What do you used to call her, though? What's the way we address her?
Aunt May.
Aunt Maybelle. Aunt May. Okay. And your brothers?
Elder Willie James lives in New York.
Mm-hmm.
City has been there 40 years. Also, my sister lived there 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
And now she has moved back south and built a home in New Bern, North Carolina, which we were very, very happy.
I know you were. So you'll be going to see her soon, hopefully.
Yeah, very soon.
And you got one more brother.
One brother in Washington, D.C., which is Jesse, which is our baby brother.
Okay. All right. So now let's go back to when you were a little girl growing up on the farm. What kind of things did you do?
Well,
we're talking about the early 1920s and into the 1920s.
Well, as a little girl, I just don't have too much recollection of, you know, being very, very small. But living in a rural area, my family did a lot of farming, and I didn't have that much experience in that kind of life, but that was there.
The way they lived, they were farmers?
They were farmers.
Now, tell me the story about the bull.
Well, after our father passed,
mm-hmm.
I had an uncle that took my mother's four children in his home.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, my father became ill in high school, so they came. Two brothers.
What were their names?
Arbel and Cuba Rivers.
Speak up a little bit.
Arbel and Cuba Rivers.
Mm-hmm.
So they came to Highland, took the family back to Waynesboro, as my father did.
Mm-hmm.
And so he paid. And so they decided that my mother could come back to Highland and work.
Mm-hmm.
So his uncle, which already had six children, still at home.
Mm.
He decided that he would keep us, the four children, and we were a little younger than his kids.
Mm-hmm.
And so they took us in their home. And they kept us about 4 years.
Oh.
Those were four happy years. The children in that family seemed just like our brothers and sisters. They were so close.
going back to the farm and the bull, who were you with, and tell us about that story.
Well, we were in charge of a large farm. He had a large farm.
Mm-hmm.
And on that farm, they had cattle. And we were, my cousin and I, she was 1 year, we were maybe about 11 and 12.
Mm-hmm. So this is about 1928
or someplace in there, maybe 1930 or something.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were in charge of bringing them up out of the pasture, but they had two shepherd dogs.
Mm-hmm. What were their names?
Nero and Dixie Lee.
Oh, still remember the names.
Yeah, I remember the names because we would get those. We would bring the cows up. We was in charge of bringing all those cows up to the barn
mm-hmm.
in the afternoon. And so we would just tell the dogs to go bring them up. And we would go in the pasture,
mm-hmm.
but they would round them up and bring them up.
Mm.
Bring them down the lane to those two big barns.
Smart dogs.
And so we, that was our job to do that. And try to be in, so that was just our main job. And they had two bulls, and one was named Buck.
Mm-hmm.
And so my cousin and I, we knew how to make it mad, angry.
And what was your cousin's name?
Clara.
She a lot of fun?
She was a weird kid. Yeah. And we did everything together. And so but this was our main, one of our jobs.
Mm-hmm.
So we would pick at that bull sometime and make it mad.
Mm-hmm.
The place was fenced in.
Mm-hmm.
And so we had a little crawl space under the, little rollover space under the fence,
mm-hmm.
under the wire.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't barbed wire, all of it wasn't. So.
Mm-hmm.
And when he would get mad and he'd start to want us, we'd run to that little place and we'd just roll over, go into that little hole and run under there. So we did a lot of little mischievous things, but we was very young.
Mm-hmm.
I guess we were no more than about 20.
Okay.
But you go farm tour and learn a lot.
Did you two go to school together?
We went to school together.
And what was your school like? Describe it to me.
It was a little three-room school.
What grades?
We went to sixth or seventh grade.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Six or seven.
Mm-hmm. And what was your favorite subject as a little girl?
My reading and writing.
You loved to write early on.
I loved to write early on. I loved to read early on. And I loved it. Still love it.
Okay. So, what were Christmases? Tell me about one of your favorite Christmases as a little girl. What kind of food did you have? What did they do that was made it special?
Yeah, what made Christmas special? We children, you know, with our mom, but maybe one of the boys would go out in this deep woods. We had beautiful wooded areas where I would go out and
speak up a little bit.
We'd go out and gather holly.
Mm-hmm.
Prettiest holly trees. And we'd bring the holly and made a cedar back and decorate it. House. I still remember that fresh holly.
Mm.
And that was just beautiful.
So you didn't have to buy it in the stores and you could just go out and pick it.
Just get it off those huge holly trees. And I've tried to find some around my house here in Trinity, but I've not been able to find any holly. But that was lovely.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful decoration.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, back then they didn't do a lot of decorating. Everybody in the country, they had those big red bells and,
mm-hmm.
and whatever. They go from one corner of that room to the other with this. They put that red bell right down in the center.
And that was pretty.
That was pretty.
Okay, so what did they have like for Christmas dinner? I mean, what would they do? Who would cook?
Well, they started cooking bacon
mm-hmm.
long before Christmas. And at that time, I was living with this family.
Mm-hmm.
And they bake cakes of every kind, every description. Long before Christmas, they built a safe or something up with cakes. And
a pie safe?
Pie safe.
Mm-hmm.
And so we had plenty of cake. So, and you know, of course, they raised their meats and plenty of cake and ham. And back then, we didn't have that much turkey, but we had chickens.
Mm-hmm.
They even on Christmas morning, that big, beautiful plate of cake would be put on the table for breakfast.
On Christmas morning.
Christmas morning.
Was that exciting to the children?
It was really exciting. And of course, we had plenty of ham. And things like that.
Okay. Did they ever have a Christmas play or singing? Did you sing or what?
Well, in out of school, sometimes we'd have Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
But, school. But we didn't have them at church, mm-hmm. like we do now. We had it at school. Mm-hmm.
But you remember Christmas being a happy time?
Very happy. We didn't get that much, but what we got was so happy to get. Maybe an apple and an orange and a couple of sticks of candy. And they had the best raisins back then because they would be on a stem. They were so good, and they had candy with nuts.
Mm-hmm.
Not very many, just a little thing. And maybe a tiny little dog.
Mm-hmm. And you were just happy with what you had.
Just as happy.
Not like these kids today. They want everything.
Everything.
And still not happy.
My little grandson said they showed a video. And when they came down and looked at their toys, it had so much stuff. They said, well, we got everything we asked for.
Mm.
And then they also got some things that they already had. I guess the parents must have forgot. They already had this.
Well, now when you got sick in those days, in the 20s and the 30s growing up, what kind of medicine did they give?
They didn't have anything to give you but castor oil and black draw. Yeah, what was wrong with it?
Castor oil and black what?
Black draw.
What's
some
black draw?
A powder
mm-hmm.
that every family had back then, the Epsom salt they had then. So whatever was ailing you, one of those things was supposed to cure you.
Did you get better?
Yeah. Never went to a doctor.
Never went to a doctor?
Not until I was a grown woman.
Mm.
Nearly grown.
Okay. So, a pretty healthy lifestyle then. Fresh food and... How would you keep your food cold in those days? You remember anything?
I don't. Frankly, I don't. I know they had our storehouse. I don't ever remember us having an ice house. I don't know how they kept it. I often wonder myself how they could keep food
mm-hmm.
back then without it spoiling.
Mm-hmm.
They kept molasses in a keg, because
mm-hmm.
that wasn't small anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I think maybe they had flour.
Mm-hmm.
They had some place to keep it. But we didn't have a lot of fresh meats. We had cured meat.
Okay, that's how they kept it.
Yeah. And the chickens and things, I don't know, I guess they would just cook them.
Mm-hmm. Fresh. Well, now, what was it like when you were a little girl going to town? Did you ever go to town, and what was that like?
It was fun. We'd go to town on Saturday.
How would you travel?
By wagon. They had a T-Model Ford,
mm-hmm.
but my older cousin, he would have a car, and my uncle would take us into town on his wagon. But we had some older girls.
Mm-hmm.
And they would never let him, they would never ride up in town in that wagon. We'd get out before he took that wagon up in town and we'd walk on up there.
Oh, y'all kind of proud.
Yeah, they'd be walking on silly the wagon, although they knew that's all we was traveling. But that's what we would do, we'd get out.
Mm-hmm.
We'd take it on up there for the park, the horses or mules or whatever in that wagon.
Mm-hmm.
And so, that's and I never remember staying in town until after dark. I knew that. friends and things. So we wanted to stay in town sometime. You know, they stay up there
and court a little bit.
Uh-huh, we went, and just about dark, they would call us and we'd have to go get back in the car and go back to the car. But I just wondered I don't think I know what Waynesboro looked like at night now.
Because you've never been there in town.
As far as I know, I don't know what it looked like up there at night.
We'll have to go back and see.
Just a lot of changes.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to go to the beach to go back. We'd go over the same route from town out to Allen, maybe 5 miles out of town. We lived in a community that was called Sneedsburg.
Mm-hmm.
With two churches.
What were the name of those churches?
Mount Pleasant and Sneedsburg. And they were not too far apart. There was a railroad there, so we would go to Steesburg.
Was that a Baptist church?
Steesburg was a Methodist church. Where we'd go there this second Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd go to Mount Pleasant on the first Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever church had service, you know, one would have service on one Sunday and on the other. So we'd always attend, after Sunday school, we'd walk to the other, down the railroad, especially the young folks, we'd walk to the other church and attend service down there. Or either they would walk from Mount Pleasant back up to Sneeze, but that's the way we attended.
So the church, in those days, they got along pretty good.
They worked together. And especially enjoyed the revival.
Mm-hmm.
That's one time we could get to go out at night. We go to the revivals in different communities.
And travel around to the revival. That was exciting to see.
That was exciting. To go to every revival.
Now, what was revival like in those days? Did they sing and shout, or what did they do?
Well, they didn't do too much shouting.
Mm-hmm.
They did quite a bit of singing. They sang a lot of hymns.
Mm-hmm. What's one of the oldest songs you remember singing?
This
song would be, I would say, if you remembered, it would be about 50 or 60 years old.
I remember we had a Sunday school superintendent named Mr. Edwards.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, his daughter, we all went to school with him. She moved here, so we were still friends when we were in high school. And I remember Mr. Edwards, when, you know, they would raise hymns and he would sing a charge to keep our hands.
Okay.
My God to glorify. And of course, I learned just about all the old hymns when I was a child.
Mm-hmm.
And now when people sing hymns, I know every
one of
them because I learned them as a child. They sung hymns back then.
Mm-hmm.
And I love hymns today because they don't sing hymns like they do. But I can remember him singing all the old hymns and I know just
and you know them right today, you know.
Yeah.
So it's good to teach your children some songs like that, then they'll remember them when they get old.
And the revivals, they had a mourner's bench. And when everybody was 12 years old, I guess, at that revival, it was time for them to go to the mourner's bench.
Mm-hmm.
And that was one time that you'd go after you was 12, or when you was 12.
Mm-hmm.
They had the boys on one side and the girls on the other. They'd just be saying, "Oh Lord, Lord, Savior," just be a chorus. That's what we learned to say.
So everybody said it together.
Oh Lord, yeah, they was right together. "Oh Lord, Lord, Savior." And the old folks would be over here singing, Lord, they'd be patting and singing. And when everybody's child, when one of the children would get saved or something, they'd jump up and shout it and the mama would start. Then that's the time for the mama to rejoice.
Uh-huh.
And so that's what they did.
And that was a good
that
time.
That was good because that somebody got religion.
His
religion last night. I got my religion last night. But everybody that went to that mama's bench.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them still think that same religion was going to last them the rest of their life. Now, we're not taught that. We do not think no one religion is going to last you. You probably didn't hardly know what you were doing.
Uh-huh.
And we do not teach that one religion is going to last you all your life because you don't really understand.
What
but
you do.
You got a good start.
Good.
Good
so
start.
It's good to get a good start.
Good start, that's what it was. And what we had to do. But as you grow, you learn more, you know.
Okay.
You're taught more.
Okay. All right. Let's talk about when you were a teenager and you had moved to High Point, North Carolina.
Yeah. My uncle became ill, so my mother came back and got him.
Well,
I'm ahead of myself. I was the first one that came. My mother was working it with this family.
Uh-huh.
And she was like, she did the cooking. And so I was the first to come. And by that time, I had had two other girls that was here, was in High Point. And so my mama let me. The girls, you know where I grew up, they had good jobs.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody was working, so she had one of them to bring me back to High Point with them when I was about just turned 15.
Mm-hmm.
And so she took me up there in the house where she was working. We had a room in that house. And I learned to cook and do a lot of things there. That was my first
job.
Mm-hmm. Just turned 15.
And who else worked at that house?
Well, my husband's mother, she did a lot of cleaning at that house. It was a boarding house.
Uh-huh.
And she had
her name?
Her name was Patty Scott. So she had how many boys?
Eight
boys. And the one she would take with her.
Mm-hmm.
She would take the one named Frank,
mm-hmm.
and then they would have me on. She would wash windows and things, and it was a two-story house, and so she had him up there one day. He was washing the windows outside this room. You know, it was a, I don't know how he got on that roof, because it was so you could stand on it,
mm-hmm.
wide enough not to fall.
Mm-hmm.
And so he had Von Amy. He washed windows and things with Von Amy. He dropped it, you know, all the way down, you know. And,
mm-hmm.
and his mother would say, tell me to go down and get it for me.
How would she say it?
She said, little daughter. She always called her daughter-in-law. She's daughter.
But you weren't her daughter-in-law.
No, then, but she always called your daughter. She said, little daughter, will you run down and get that for my son? And so I went down and got it, and we gave it to him at the window. And he said he was wasn't wanting to wash windows. He was trying to get through so he could get out and go up on the street. That's what they call a street in our hometown. He might have been about 17, 16 or 17.
Young man.
Yeah, he was younger than
that. Still a boy, really. Uh-huh.
And so, well, that's the first time I seen him.
So did you, when you saw this young 17-year-old, did you say, oh, that's going to be my husband?
No, I didn't. I did not. And
what
happened?
Uh-huh.
He had three sisters, and he had one my age. And they just lived right down the street. We lived right on the edge of the white settlement.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, Lila said, they call them sisters, call them my sister Scott. Got the prettiest little old fat-faced girl, and I want you to meet her.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, all right, because when we lived in High Point before, we didn't live in this section.
Mm-hmm.
And my little friends was over somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
But in the meantime, my mother had met these people.
Mm-hmm.
And she wanted me to meet this girl. And of course, my mother had joined another little church.
What was the name of that church?
Church of God of Prophecy.
Church of God or Church of God of Prophecy?
Church of God of Prophecy.
Oh, okay.
The Church of God.
Okay.
And so she let me go down there.
Mm-hmm.
And I met Maul. We were the same age.
Mm-hmm.
And so we just got along real good.
Mm-hmm. And what happened that day?
Well, they had a brother that was older than my husband.
Mm-hmm.
So he worked in the Hunter's Museum.
And what was his name?
His name was Willie. And so guess, so he would bring little socks home. At that time, we girls, up until 15 years old, we were wearing ankle socks.
Mm-hmm.
And so he gave out 3 pair of socks. And she brought them out in the yard. We were outside.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, here's some socks, where they said you could hang them. And I was so thrilled over those little ankles.
Mm-hmm.
In the meantime, Frank
mm-hmm.
was out there, but he was mischievous.
Mm-hmm.
And so he had, I don't know where he got those things, but they always knew how to shoot little rubber bands.
Mm-hmm.
And so he started shooting rubber bands, hitting me with rubber bands. And of course, I didn't say nothing. And so that's one of my first revelations. Paying me any attention.
Mm-hmm.
He shot, hit me, you know, with those things.
Mm-hmm.
Like, turn out, they said, the little boy said, like, he said, he'd hit you,
mm-hmm.
run you and all that.
Mm-hmm.
But by us going to the same church,
mm-hmm.
but then I lived.
Okay.
Started talking. I remember 15 and just turned 15.
Just turned 15.
Just turned 15 and started talking to him.
Mm-hmm. So that was, see, that was about, let's see, 1933. Okay. So you were living in High Point. You were met a young man named Frank, and you were going to Church of God, and your life was sort of, things were sort of new and meeting new people. Now, so he started coming to see you, or?
No, we'd always...
How did you court back in those days?
One other church.
Okay.
Mostly. You know, so we're at the church all the time, so we see one another at church.
Mm-hmm. So that's how he courted you?
Mostly. And sometimes, you know, after I got a little older, he started coming to our house.
Mm-hmm. And what did Nanny do when he come over to your house?
Well... We had a porch, a swing on the porch.
Uh-huh.
And we'd sit out on the porch and swing. And so at 9 o'clock,
mm-hmm.
he remembers this well. He said, she said, Lina said, it's time for you to come in. Come in now and let Frank go home and go to bed.
So he said he wouldn't want, she knew
home.
He didn't want to go home and go to bed.
That's what he always said. Sister Nanny, I don't know that I didn't want to go home. In the meantime, he had a job back. He had a job in a drugstore.
Mm-hmm.
That's where the young kids worked then, younger ones. And he got this job at the drugstore.
Mm-hmm.
And so, the way I would see him then, I told you I always liked to read.
Mm-hmm.
I would order a book, which mm-hmm. didn't cost me about 10 or 15 cents.
Mm-hmm.
And he had a brand new bicycle.
Mm.
It had a little bell on it. So I'd order that book, and they would send his, they'd send the trips out, the medicine and whatever you order from this drugstore. These boys had to ride on their bicycle.
Mm-hmm.
And so he would.
And that's one of his first jobs. Probably.
And so he would ride to my house with that one book.
Mm-hmm. And would y'all talk after
we'd
he
talk
got
for
there?
A little while. But I'd order a book, you know, when it was working.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when it's nice to work or something. I guess I read all the, you know, little books,
magazines.
Little magazines. I'd order something.
Mm-hmm.
They'd send anything out.
Mm-hmm.
Often talks about how they send them out in the rain and snow.
Mm. To different neighborhoods.
Different neighborhoods. People sit up in their houses and all that stuff, but they have to take those trips.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so this was in the 30s, and so moving on up. Tell me what happened next.
Well, it rocked on till I was about 17.
Mm-hmm.
And remember, this was the first boyfriend.
Mm-hmm. Your first real boyfriend.
Real boyfriend.
Mm-hmm.
And so about 17. And finally he decided he was going to ask me to marry.
Mm-hmm.
Well, of course I didn't have, I said, I don't know if I said anything much, but anyway we start planning to get married.
Uh-huh.
And so we got married in 1940.
1935. Okay. And then, so where did you live?
Where did I live?
After you got married.
We moved to, and his mother. We stayed there. We moved in his mother's home. And then we moved in our own little apartment because they had two great big apartment houses up next to the church. Mm-hmm. And his sister lived in.
Which one?
One. Pico.
Mm-hmm.
Pico. Lived in one in a couple of rooms, and then Frank moved into.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's where my first child was.
And your first child was, what was her name? What is her name?
Her name is Jacqueline. Frankie Jacqueline.
Who named her?
He named her Frankie. And Piccola named her Jacqueline.
Oh, so you didn't name her.
I didn't name her. And when she was born, they called him at the drugstore. And he took off home and called the doctor.
Were you scared when you had your first one, or were you pretty okay about it?
I wasn't scared. Mm-hmm. I knew you'd be scared of anything.
Mm-hmm.
And so Jackie was born.
So you thought you had a little doll baby?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we thought Jackie was a doll. So she was the first girl that was born. Let me see. She wasn't the first grandchild.
Well, on your side.
On the son. She was the first little Scotton girl.
First little Scotton girl. So they probably spoiled her pretty.
She was very spoiled. First little Scotton girl, it was born because the older sisters had sons. But, you know, they weren't Scotton.
Right. So she got.
But she got the privilege of being the first Scotton.
Oh, boy.
Granddaughter.
Uh-huh.
You know, for our son.
Uh-huh. So she has a sort of a privileged spot there. All right. So you were young, and you were sort of growing up with your children back in those days, in their 30s, and late 30s and early 40s. So tell us a little bit about your move from High Point to Philly. At one time, didn't you?
We're
into
1943,
1944.
1942.
Okay. World War II.
Yes. My husband had come to war. Was the war had not? Yes, it had to come to war. I think they had declared war. You know, it was at war with Japan.
Mm-hmm.
And so he did not know his brothers were not there. And they got jobs in the war plants, shipyards, and all that. And so then I had four children.
Mm-hmm.
And so they moved us to Philly. I took the three children. I mean, four children.
Mm-hmm.
You know, about training.
Mm-hmm.
So while I was a little friend of the city, he wanted us to come and go to the block. And by that time, he had a job in one of the war plants.
Mm-hmm. That was a pretty good job.
It was a good job. I guess it might have been the best one he ever had at that time. And so at that time, they were building homes for war workers.
Mm-hmm.
The people were coming out from the South and different places to move them. Moved there to work in those plants. So my first brand new house, apartment, they were a complex. And we moved in one of the complexes. And they were real nice.
Brand new.
And the first time we'd had heat, you know, steam heat, gas heat.
Mm-hmm.
And my apartments, they were very nice.
How did you enjoy living there?
Enjoyed it very much. Because then that was the first time we had automatic washers.
Ooh.
We had a lot of
automatic washer?
I wash it down in the basement because I don't wash it for a quarter.
So you got to experience some modern day conveniences.
Yes, right there in that complex.
Mm-hmm.
And I made a lot of friends.
Like who? Do you remember any of them?
Well, my best friend was named Victoria Williams.
Mm-hmm.
And for so many years we kept in touch with my mother.
Mm-hmm.
And 7 years ago we went back to Paris.
Mm-hmm.
And I just moved back after two more children, we moved back.
Mm-hmm.
But we lived there from early 42 to 46. And of course, Javier started school there.
Mm-hmm.
And went to school there.
So you had Jacqueline, Donnie, Mickey, and Ted. And you had another little girl.
Ted was born in Philadelphia.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a little girl named Teresa Ernestine. She was born in Philadelphia.
Mm-hmm.
I had two children.
Oh, okay. Your family?
So my family had grown.
Uh-huh.
From
4 to 6.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. All right. So then you enjoyed your stay in Philadelphia?
I enjoyed it very much. In fact, I didn't know how to want to leave Philadelphia. You know, thought it'd be after the war.
Mm-hmm.
But the jobs were not going, and the plan let a lot of people go.
Mm-hmm.
And so we moved back home.
Mm-hmm. All right. So when you moved back home to High Point, North Carolina,
mm-hmm.
So where did y'all live?
We lived in a section that we call the West End.
Mm-hmm.
So we lived over there.
Now your mom was still in High Point.
My mom was still in High Point.
Okay. All right. And so how long did you live in the West End?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Not too long.
Not too long. My husband built a house. At that time his family was a Mason.
Mm-hmm.
And most of the boys was brickmen.
Mm-hmm.
At that time he had come back home, I guess he was laying brick at that time. He had to lay brick. His father was amazing, and most of the crowd.
Mm-hmm.
And so he built us a home.
Mm. That's pretty
we
good.
Our first little home in a little section of High Point called Massey Dome.
Mm-hmm.
And then before we moved there, we had started another family.
Oh my goodness.
In 1950.
So you wanted more children?
Well, I didn't have too much to, at that time you thought children was natural. You didn't know.
It's just a natural part of family life.
I guess we thought it was nothing you could do about it.
Mm-hmm.
I can't remember anybody ever saying you could do anything about it.
So you started a second family.
Second family, that's what we call them our second family.
In your new home.
She was about.
Who?
Gwen.
Okay.
Gwen was about. She was about 6 months old when I moved to Pennsylvania. I think that was her age at that time.
Mm-hmm.
He built us a nice little block house.
Mm-hmm.
So
well now, all right, so we're going into the 50s then. The 50s, and so what was life like in the 50s? They say that the 50s was an idyllic time in America. Things were pretty easy going, and you know, you had television and some things that were being developed in the 50s, and there was no war. This was peacetime during the 50s. So what was life like for you in the 50s? Do you remember?
Well, it was okay. That's when I had these next 4 children in the 50s. So mostly my time was just trying to raise those
take care of?
I had three girls and a boy in the family.
What are their names?
Well, after Queen, Rebecca was born 2 years later. Gail was born 2 years later.
That's me.
And Richard was born 2 years later. Mm-hmm. And so I was raising
children.
And by that time, I'm baby in school. So I was older than I was in.
How did you keep it going?
I don't know. I often wonder how I kept it going. And at that time, my husband was a man that he had started preaching. He was a minister.
Mm-hmm.
And when Gail was a baby, he accepted his first little church, and it was in Rock Hill, South Carolina, which was over 100 miles, I think, from my point.
And you
know no better. I took Gail.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was a baby. And so, at that time, two of the children was not home. We had gone to, one had gone to college.
Mm-hmm.
I had three boys at home.
You had three sons.
Three sons at home.
That's right. You had some teenage sons.
At home. And one girl has gone to college.
Mm-hmm.
And so, from that time on, we seemed like we just went into a different state.
Lifestyle.
Mm-hmm. At that time, they were, and that was our first pastor in Rock Hill, South Carolina.
So you were a minister's wife.
At that time, I was a minister's wife.
How did you enjoy being a minister's wife?
Well, I enjoyed it. You know, we did a lot of traveling for about 20 years.
Mm.
And I raised this last set of children, raised them going up and down the road to different churches.
Mm-hmm.
Because he pastored Rock Hill, South Carolina, Liberty, North Carolina.
Were there some Sundays you wish you could have just stayed home?
Yes, but I could only stay when the weather was real bad. Mm-hmm. He used to tell me to stay home and keep the children home.
Mm-hmm.
And then I stayed in Liberty about 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
At that time, Ricky was born. Ricky was about 4 weeks old when he was in Liberty.
In the 1956.
Yeah, and then we stayed there about 4 years. Then we went to Greensboro.
Mm-hmm.
We stayed there about 4 years. Then we went to Durham, North
Carolina.
Mm-hmm. Stayed there for a while. And each time we, except Greensboro, each time we traveled far.
Mm-hmm.
Durham
and then.
In Kannapolis, North Carolina.
Robbins.
No, Robbins.
I thought Robbins was after.
Robbins was after Greensboro.
No. We went from Greensboro to Bragg-Town.
Yeah.
And then from Bragg-Town, because when I was about 14 or something, we went to Robbins.
Yeah.
15, something like that.
And then we went to Kannapolis.
Mm-hmm.
Then we went back to Bragg-Town.
Mm-hmm. And stayed several more years.
Yeah, we were traveling. We did a lot of traveling. And for one amazing thing, we always say we never had a bad accident.
Mm-hmm.
We'd get out in the snow. Didn't have hotels and motels back then.
Mm-hmm.
And we traveled in all kinds of ways.
Mm-hmm.
At that time, we had on Sundays, you'd have about three services. You'd have your Sunday morning, Sunday school, then you'd have morning service. You probably just ride it somewhere for in the afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'd come back to our church and have service.
Mm-hmm. My goodness, so
and
it was
then
a
we
full?
Didn't get full day.
Mm-hmm.
For years, because people were real busy. The churches worked together very good in a lot of these areas.
Mm-hmm.
We were always gone.
So you were a worker in the church.
Yeah.
What church was this now that you belong to?
The Church of Prophecy.
Okay. So your work is Church of God of Prophecy. Church of God.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing. For years, you and your husband. Okay, so I guess during that time you just traveled the state of North Carolina.
Yeah.
And met a lot of people.
A lot of
good people.
A lot of good people. I still have a lot of friends. Love to meet them in different conventions.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we were into the 60s and 70s, and so you and your husband were busy pastoring.
Our last pastor was in a bank here in High Point for a couple of years, and then my health was not good at that time. And the next church he pastored, he was appointed to when I wasn't able to travel.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And so I don't think he wanted to school without us. And of course, we had a home. By that time, we had another home in the Trinity, North Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
Children was in school, and we were pretty well set.
Mm-hmm.
And so we didn't want to go to children. I felt like we had traveled, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I had felt myself. I feel like traveling.
So you for the most of your life, you've provided a stable home for your children.
That's right.
And a nourishing environment for your children. Raise your kids. Okay, well now, what are some of the interesting things that you like to do with all your children flown the nest and you're here? What do you like to do, and what are your interests as a 77-year-old accomplished woman, having raised 9 children successfully and pastored all over the state? What do you like to do?
I attend church. We came back to our home church.
Mm-hmm.
And I came back to our home church. And we were members there.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have a lot of activities. When we're able, we're there at the church thing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, here.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we belong to a senior citizen group. Mm-hmm. That keeps you real busy.
Do you still enjoy reading?
I enjoy reading, and I began writing when I was young.
Now, I understand you've published a few poems. Where is that book?
Well, I have.
I'd like for you to read a few of them for me.
I have the.
Where is it? I want you to read a few. Go get Orlando for a minute. We're taping Mom, so.
I might have one in the second chapter joint, and it might be over there in the little book stand.
Okay, I'm going to stop. We're going to stop this because I'd like for you to read some of your favorite selections. Just one. Okay. And then we're going to wind down. We've enjoyed learning more about your life growing up on the farm and how you met your husband. And what I want to do is we're going to stop it, so I want her to get one of her poems that she's written.
Okay. Yeah.
This is to my children and grandchildren. I have no earthly treasures to bequeath you. I have no inheritance of wealth. No precious jewelry of silver or gold, and no fame. No noble or great deeds can be attributed to my having passed this way. I hope I have left you something more precious. It is my love for my future. In him I have found a place, a refuge, a savior, a comfort. A bridge over troubled waters. I have tried to instill in you a love for God, the strength to overcome the many obstacles that you will encounter, to always be able to see and find a way to continue on the right path, to have a spirit of forgiveness and not hate, and remember that to fail is not a reason to give up, but a challenge to try again. Always believe things will be better tomorrow, no matter how dark they are today.
Oh, Beautiful, Mother. Beautiful. Could you just read us one more, Mom, of one of your writings? So my mother is a writer.
This is a prayer of thanks. Lord, we appreciate the time that has been so lovingly granted to us. You have blessed us in so many countless ways, and for all the things you have provided for us. We thank you for seeing the dawning of each new day, knowing fully that tomorrow is not promised. We appreciate our home and our family, our friends and our church family. We appreciate the sunshine and the rain, and for the loved ones that have gone before us and taught us the things that are most important. For our pastors and leaders that continue to teach us even today, for guiding us through the most these most difficult times. Help us to realize we have come this far by faith and that your grace is sufficient.
Lovely. We have one more you'd like to read before we turn the tape off. Zoom in on the back of that, the back of the magazine. Hold your magazine up, Mom, so they can see. This is a collection of writings and thoughts of Mrs. Lina Bernice Rivers Scotton. So when are we going to get you published? And we'll have to look into
doing
that.
This is one that I like. It's
read that to us.
Probably one of my favorites. And one Sunday morning, I think maybe I heard, probably heard this towel, but then I just did the rest myself. I did hear this.
Okay.
It says, "Have you lost Jesus?" And then I went on to say, "Mary and Joseph lost him. We can be in the church and lose him. In many ways, we have lost him in our love for others, in disobedience, and the way we act, look, and live. As soon as Mary and Joseph lost Jesus, they immediately turned and began to look for him until they had found him. We can be so caught up in things of the world, which would include our work and many things that seem so necessary. For instance, comforting. They bury us over as a heavy blanket of weight. We must somehow search for a way out until we find him again."
Ooh. Oh, that's lovely. That's powerful. So you have been a writer and a mother, and continue to write, Mom.
Yeah.
We can do. We got time for one more, several more.
Mm-hmm. Give your talents and gifts to God, and He will do things with them that will surprise you. I am impressed by the fact that talent is to be used. It is a God-given gift that is sometimes hidden or suppressed until it is like a flame that is sometimes smothered but refuses to go out. It comes out in all forms. It brings out the best in a favorite beauty. It is song, dance, poetry, and a world of art, and is too numerous to comprehend. It is dreams of the young and the old that can explore into greatness.
Mm. you're a prolific writer.
Really giving you a third degree down here?
No.
She's giving us her poetry.
She's reading her writings to us.
All right, because now I don't even have a towel for this one, but I read it.
Oh, you got plenty of time.
What is man that thou art mindful of him? In other words, what is man that I should fear him? Why fear man that can only destroy the body, but rather God that can destroy body and soul? If I had my life to live over, and know as I know now, that since time is a fleeting element, and man's destiny is not of his own making. The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Therefore fear and cripple the soul, and paralyze the mind. The fear of God can garner wisdom, and wisdom can garner, or rather bring forth life, and life can reflect and shed understanding. Mm-hmm. Understanding ensures clear path to his purpose.
Woo! That was deep.
Finished.
Is that all you'd like to read to us? Just read that one line poem that you wrote, which I really, really love. And then we will wind down for this morning, if you can find it in there.
One line.
Mm-hmm.
I must have been.
It's a one line poem that I think is real powerful. And we're going to conclude.
What is five letters?
No, it's just one line. If you can find it.
Are you sure it's real mine?
Mm-hmm. Isn't that what I mean?
A new resurrection. A new beginning.
All right. That's it. Thank you, Mom. You're a beautiful writer, beautiful mother, and we want you to continue to write.
Well, this is one of the loves of my life. Because when I find a lot of comfort in it, because this is not, it's really done by inspiration. And I feel inspired.
Do you have a favorite song? Or one that you love throughout the years?
But one of them is just so sweet, to trust in Jesus.
Why is that your favorite song?
Because the song means a lot to me.
Mm-hmm.
And because, you know, since I've been old enough to know him, I've had to trust him for a lot of things.
Thank you, Mother. You did a beautiful job. Lina Scotton.
In the Bible days, she had been sick, sick so very long. But she heard my Jesus was passing by, so she joined the gathering throng. And why? She was pushing her way through. Someone asked her, what are you trying to do? She said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I know I'll be made whole. She cried, oh, money here and there, and till she had no more to spare. The doctors, they done all they could, but their medicine would do no good. When she touched him, the Savior didn't see, but still he turned around and cried, "Somebody touch me." She said it was, "I who just want to touch the hem of your garment. I know I'll be made whole right now." She stood there